Welcome everybody to Deakin. I hope you're feeling nice and relaxed. The music set the mood for this afternoon. My name is Simon Hand. I'm the CEO of Deakin Prime, the corporate education arm of Deakin. It's our great pleasure today to host you all. Lots of familiar faces. We always love to have you back, and some new faces, which is terrific. So welcome. We run a number of these events throughout the year, and this is our second lunch for the year. And we are very fortunate today to have Tania de Jong with us, talking on the topic of creativity and innovation in an era of disruption. I would challenge anyone in this room to say that their business or who they work for hasn't been disrupted in some way in recent years, whether that be through digital, global competition, or a whole range of disruptive factors. So disruption and change is a constant, and that can be then a challenge within an organisation to look at creativity and innovation as ways to work with that disruption, if you like, to get positive outcomes. So we've been fortunate at Deakin to work with Tania for almost a decade now in various initiatives, and is absolutely regarded as a leader in this space. So Tania is a leading Australian soprano, social entrepreneur, spiritual journey woman, global speaker, and creative innovation catalyst. I know what two or three of those things are, but perhaps Tania can explain the others. But Tania founded Creativity Australia and Creative Universe, and works with disadvantaged communities through the With One Voice Choir social inclusion programs, and there's been a fairly significant connection with Deakin and Geelong in that regard. Tania speaks and performs internationally as a soloist and with her group Potpourri, who have toured overseas on over 40 occasions and released 7 CDs. Tania is founder of Music Theatre Australia Entertainment and Events and Creative Innovation Global, presenting the acclaimed CI 2010 to CI 2015 conferences. The 2013 conference was named Corporate Event of the Year in the Global Eventex Awards, well regarded and well renowned for the high calibre of global speakers that attend those events. Tania has a Bachelor of Law from the University of Melbourne and a graduate of Victorian College of the Arts, and was appointed a member of the Order of Australia in June 2008 for services to the arts as a performer and entrepreneur. Through her work, Tania has received numerous awards, including Ernst & Young Australian Social Entrepreneur of the Year as founder of The Song Room, and Tania's TED Talk has sparked international interest. Tania, I did check just before coming up, and you're pretty close to 20,000 visits by the look, so if all of you can go back and have a look at Tania's TED Talk, we can get that number up over 20,000 for her. As an interesting piece of trivia, Tania attended college in the USA on a tennis scholarship. A very versatile person, Tania. And her grandmother invented the first foldable umbrella in Vienna in 1929. Tania's recently released her first solo CD entitled Heaven on Earth, so we're very pleased to welcome Tania here today. Before we do that, we're going to play a video that Tania and her team at Creative Universe recently created for their recent conference that looks at predictions for the future. So we'll play that video and then Tania will come up. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. That was a video, as Simon mentioned, we created for Creative Innovation Global CI 2015 conference. It just finished about a month ago, and the theme was From Disruption to Sustainable Growth. And what do you think of that video? I'd love some comments. Are you scared? Are you excited? Any thoughts about that?
It's a mixture of challenges as well as opportunities.
Absolutely, it is. Absolutely. And that's some of the things we'll talk about today and how we can make the most of these opportunities and how we can actually shift our thinking. And it really does come down to shifting our thinking, because if we stay in the mindsets that we've been in, our 20th century industrial revolution mindsets, we're going to be left behind. There was a number of recent estimates, but as you saw on that video, it's estimated that 47% of middle class jobs will become redundant due to robotics and new technologies. And that means that a lot of people are going to be unemployed. It's going to create a lot of social disadvantage. And it means that you're going to have to be very technologically skilled to keep up. And all of us are going to, in a sense, have to retrain ourselves with new skills around creativity, innovation, technology, and so on to keep up. The other thing, I guess, is that there was a figure, I think, that recently came out that said that 40% of Standard & Poor's companies will cease to exist. And so companies that fail to invest in creativity and innovation, and people who fail to invest in their own creativity and innovation, will cease to exist. It'll just stagnate and become redundant. And I guess all of us are here because we don't want to do that. And we want to work out how we can be ahead of the curve and really thinking forwards. The other thing that's going to change is the type of leaders that will be required. The type of leaders, I would call them creative change. Instead of the word leader, let's think of them as creative change entrepreneurs. People who are completely prepared, I guess, to fail, who are prepared to try new ideas, who are flexible, compassionate. That's the sort of leadership that we're going to need in this new world. So I wanted to start off, though, by just asking a question and just saying, who here thinks that they're creative? Excellent. Is there anyone who thinks they're not creative? No, there's a lady here, okay. What was your name?
Gabby.
Gabby, and where do you work?
Bank Vic,
and what do you do?
I look after deceased accounts and some accounting side
okay.
of the business.
And why don't you think you're creative?
I just wasn't born with that gene.
But so, do you solve a lot of problems in your daily work?
Yes.
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, is Gabby creative?
Yes.
Yeah. So creativity is not about the arts, okay? Like, it's great. I mean, sure. Like, we all actually do have a right-brained creative gene. Yeah, we all do. Believe me. But don't think of creativity as, you know, painting, singing, poetry, dancing. Creativity is all about thinking about new ideas and thinking about new ways of doing things more efficiently. I would say we're all creative. So ask the question again. Who here? Well, actually, is there anyone in the room who thinks that they're not creative in the definition I've just described? Very good. You don't want me to single you out, that's why you're not answering. Anyway, look, here's a little thought teaser. Many of you have probably seen it. There's no right answer here, but who sees that lady turning clockwise? Yep. And who sees her turning anti-clockwise? Okay, and who sees her turning both directions? Yeah, okay. So apparently if you see her turning clockwise, you're in a more right-brained headspace at the moment. If you see her turning anti-clockwise, more left-brained. And if both directions, using both sides of your brain, which is very good. So this session is very much about how we can untap more of the right side of our brain, because that's what we're going to need. To set ourselves apart from robots and machines, which don't have a right side of a brain, we have to unlock more of the right side of our brain capabilities. And our brain is like a giant battery. The right side charges it up and the left side uses the battery. Now, in today's world, about 85% of our time is spent in the left side of our brain being overwhelmed by barrages of information. Who feels overwhelmed by how much information you have coming at you every day? Hands right up. Yeah, two hands. Yeah, so what we have to do is we have to start getting more into the right side of our brain. But just to recap, the left side of the brain is about logic, very analytical, etc., etc. So that's what deals with all this information, puts it in its little boxes. The right side is about thinking beyond the box. And the right side of the brain is all about imagination, intuition, creative functions. And that's, again, what sets us apart from machines. So where are we now in the world? Well, we pretty much saw that on the video. But we're moving from these 20th century top-down, very institutional models to much more flexible, collaborative, distributed communities. We're moving from an era of enormous consumption, you know, you think of Sex in the City and all the shoes and the dresses and everything, to an era of greater collaboration where we share more things. And we're actually sharing our assets rather than just holding on to them. So who here rents their house out on Airbnb? Not yet, but it's a great fundraising opportunity. And of course, who's taken Uber? Who's taken an Uber taxi before? Yeah, not so many people yet. It's really good, I highly recommend it. And look at the valuation on those companies. And they haven't been around very long. And we're moving away from our institutions because there's an all-time low trust in institutions since the GFC. And we're moving to the era of the individual. And individuals are connecting in new and different ways. And that gives us enormous opportunities if we can work out how to connect with individuals. And particularly, one of the key topics that I'll be talking about is diversity. It's very important for us as individuals to connect with diverse other individuals, not people just like us. So it was recently said by some futurists that creativity has become the most endangered species of the 21st century. We have a broadband culture, but we literally don't have the original thought and content to fill all that space. And IBM did a CEO global study back in 2010, where it said the most important skill over these next 5 years would be creativity in an increasingly uncertain global environment. Does that graph surprise any of you?
No.
No, yeah. So I guess you're feeling more creative by the minute. So one of the important things is defining what is creativity and what is innovation. I'd like to put this out to the audience. Would someone like to define creativity and innovation, the difference between those two? Hands up, this is an interactive session. Who would like to? Yes, okay. Okay, Carla.
Okay, I was gonna say creativity can just be thinking differently, but innovation would be improving something.
Yep. Yeah, that's definitely part of it. Yes, definitely true. That's, yes?
I was going to suggest that creativity is about looking at something in a new way.
Yeah.
And innovation similarly. It's trying to find, identify new problems or come up with compelling and different ways of solving issues.
Yep, okay, terrific. All right, so they're both true, but the real key is that creativity is the ideas, okay? We all have lots of ideas, but do we implement the ideas? And innovation is where we actually implement an idea for value. And unfortunately, what happens is there's a lot of great ideas around. Who in their companies, you know, has great ideas or has people around them that are always coming up with ideas? But then do you have a pipeline to then take that idea to the next stage? Are you implementing the best of those ideas? Are you saying no at the right times? And are you saying, well, what if we did try this at the right time? Or do you always feel like you're so busy that you have to say no to every good idea? And as we saw, the most expensive 7 words are, we've always done it this way, you know. And I'm sure that a lot of you hear that. Well, this is the way we do things. Who hears that in their organisation? Hands up. Who hears, we've always done it this way, right? Okay. And the other key thing, as I said before, is to generate creativity. For creativity to spark, we need diversity. So most of us tend to spend time with people who have a similar education, similar assets, dress like us, think like us. But our greatest benefits as human beings come when we actually connect with people who are really diverse from us. One of the guys we have at the conference, Scott Anthony, who writes a lot for Harvard Business Review, he says, befriend an alien. Go out, to the cafe at your work or whatever, and you'll see that there's some people who sit alone quite often or whatever, well, go and sit with them, because actually you might have a different point of view, but some innovation may spark. You may come up with a groundbreaking idea, and who knows, you might be the next Uber. Like, it's possible. But if we keep talking in our same little circles, we're not going to have any creative innovation sparking. So we created this values diagram around creativity because all companies want increased productivity. They want that bottom line to improve. And quite often companies do not understand why creativity is important. They go, oh, creativity, oh, that sort of soft skills. Does your company think of creativity as sort of a soft thing? It's looking after we've sort of focused on the bottom line. Well, you won't get to the bottom line if you don't focus on these values around creativity, things like inspiration, connecting, passion, optimism. And they lead to these outcomes around innovation, teamwork, inspiring leadership, and so on. And they also improve well-being. And at the end of the day, you want a team that outperforms. You want a team of people who want to be at your workplace. You want to be there yourself. And you want to feel like you're contributing, that your voice is being heard. So for me, you know, as mentioned earlier in the introduction, this all, I mean, my whole journey of creativity began with my incredibly creative grandparents. And in this slide, you can see, it's my granddad there, that's my grandma. And they met in Vienna in the 1920s. They were in the studio there of Anton Hanak, who was a contemporary of Egon Schiele and Gustav Klimt. And they met like young students do and fell in love, and they used to go on dates to the local museum, and my grandmother would have her big tall umbrella and she'd say to my grandfather, you know, she'd always leave it in the cloakroom. She'd say, well, you know, what if somebody could invent like a little umbrella that fits in my handbag? You can see that little handbag there. And my grandmother started thinking about this. She said, let's keep this a secret. And she went round all the old lampshade shops in Vienna. And you can imagine Vienna in the 1920s, can't you? Beautiful, incredible architecture, lots of artists and musicians around. She went round the lampshade shops and she collected these old spokes of lampshades, you know, those hanging lampshades. And she spent about 9 months prototyping this idea, trying and failing, failing fast. One of the keys to disruptive innovation is experimentation and failing fast. And my grandmother, you can see her working notes, and she says, I tried this today, it didn't quite work, tomorrow I'm going to try this. Tried this week, I'm going to try this next, it didn't work. And finally, of course, in 1929, she invented the very first foldable umbrella, which was patented the Flirt, which I think is a very appropriate name for a little umbrella. And that was manufactured in an Austrian factory for the next 10 years until 1939, when the Nazis walked into Vienna, and my family is Jewish. And there's a long story about how I stand here today, but it's because of the strategic foresight and the creativity of my grandparents. Because of a series of incidents, which I don't have the time to go into today, they realised that if they didn't get out of Vienna really quickly, that their lives would be at stake. And my mother was only a month old at the time. And so what happened was my grandfather bribed a border guard. He was a famous sculptor. And he said, I will sculpt your bust in exchange for three passages, passes out to Switzerland over the border. And my grandmother very strategically managed to take all of the artwork to her sister's husband's place in Paris, where it was hidden right throughout the war, and much of it never returned to Australia until the last decade or so. So they managed to save not only themselves, but their incredible art. And they got to Switzerland, where the German authorities contacted my grandmother and said, we believe you have the patent for the foldable umbrella, we'd like to buy it from you. She had no choice with a little baby and not knowing where she was going to go next, but to sell her incredible patent, and was never to see another cent from her incredible invention. But next time, you know, it's raining, you get out your foldable umbrella, think of my Nana. And you know, that exact model of that umbrella is still manufactured in that Austrian factory. And when I was speaking at an innovation conference, Innovation International, end of last year, there were some delegates there from Vienna. And one of them came running up to me at the end of my speech and said, Tania, we wanted to bring you this umbrella, and it was like the model of my grandmother's umbrella, a green umbrella. He brought up to the front of the room, it was like I burst into tears. I just thought it was just such a beautiful thing to do, and everyone was so excited. So I guess I'm really lucky to stand here today. Most of the rest of that side of my family didn't survive. And we always have to be thinking ahead. That's what my grandmother taught me. And questions that we can all ask, you know, what could exist or be happening that is not happening right now? That what if question, imagine if. And then how can we learn to unlock our unique voice, our creative voice? How can we find that and the voice of those around us? So in the current climate, we talk more to boxes and screens than we do to one another. And I have a theory of boxes. You know, we get born, we're in a little bassinet, like box-like shape. We go to a house. When we go back home, it's a box-like shape. We go to school, and unfortunately, most of the time, we get taught to think in a box. We go to the supermarket. We come out with lots of little boxes. We go to work, and we have our iPhone box in our pocket, our computer box screen in front of us. We have to tick a lot of boxes because there's a lot of bureaucracy. And guess what? When we go out of this world, we go out in a... Exactly. And so I believe that life really happens on the bridges beyond the boxes. And it's incredibly important in this day and age to go outside of our boxes, to connect with people, as I said, who are very different from us, but also to connect with our loved ones, where we open our hearts, to go into nature and feel the splendour of the universe, and to unlock our creative selves in whatever way that is, including you. So it's unlocking not just our intellectual intelligence, which is increasingly becoming taken over by machines, but it's to unlock our emotional intelligence, our spiritual intelligence, our cultural intelligence, and so on. You know, who's heard, well, you've all heard of EQ, but there's also SQ, spiritual intelligence. And, you know, I like the idea of AQ, artistic intelligence. But, you know, whatever it is, we can create our own intelligences. So one of the key things that we did, actually I'll just go back on that previous slide, is that Harvard Business Review said that one of the most important things that we can do is have this cross-pollination of people, as I said before. Steve Jobs said that creativity is simply about connecting the dots. And it stands to reason that you'll connect the dots a lot better if you have this amazing creative toolbox that you can draw on when you need or want to get creative. So to have that creative toolbox, you need to have a lot of diverse experiences, you need to connect with a lot of aliens, and you need to actually feel challenged. It's actually when you get out of your comfort zone a little bit that you actually go, oh my gosh, you know, I'm starting to see the whole world in a whole different way. Well, we might just test that for a quick moment, because we're going to stand up now and take you just a little wee bit out of your comfort zone. Who here thinks that they can't sing?
Sing.
Hands up if you think you can't sing. Who's been told either by their parents, their teachers, their kids, or their partner that they can't sing? Hands right up. Okay, excellent. So usually about 85% of people say they can't sing. Now, when I was a 14-year-old girl, I desperately wanted to sing. I thought I had a strong voice. And Mum said, you know, you're really busy doing, you know, lots and lots of other things. Let's just wait for a while. But I was desperate. I thought, this is something I really want to do. I went round to my best girlfriend's house, who was learning singing. I said, would you teach me the song that you've been learning at your, you know, singing lessons? So she taught me a song, and we sang it together a few times. And she could play the piano, and then she said, now I'm going to play, you sing. She played, I sang, and at the end of it, she said to me, Tania, I don't think you should ever bother having singing lessons. You're not good enough. Being a 14-year-old girl, I believed her, like all of us have believed it when we got told that. And what that made me do is it made me think, I'm not good enough. I'm not good at this. Like, I'm not creative, for example. Whatever it was. And so I thought, okay, well, in that case, I can only do backstage in the school musical. I can't audition for the front of the house. So I did backstage in the school musical. And then finally, in year 11, I auditioned for the chorus of Oklahoma. Oklahoma. Anyway, and so I got the lead role. to my amazement. I never had a singing lesson because of what had happened. And when I walked out on that stage on that opening night of Oklahoma, I was almost sick to my stomach, and there was that little voice going, "You're not good enough, you're not good enough." Who's had that little voice?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so I walked out on that stage and I just thought, and I from then on I was always very nervous before I performed. I still get nervous, it's a good thing to get nervous. But anyway, I got out on that stage and I sang the role. I thought, this is what I want to do with my life. And it was just really an amazing opportunity. So what we're going to do now is we're going to stand up. I think I'm going to stand on this chair. Okay. So what we're going to do is I want you to stand your feet a little bit apart, your knees unlocked, your shoulders back. So lift your shoulders up, back and down. And I want you to do a big sigh. I want you to go, ha, a huge sigh. Let's make everyone in this building hear. Ha! Excellent. Now I want you to feel like there's a string going from the top of your head to the roof. Neck nice and long. Excellent. And I want you to breathe in and I want you to do another big sigh. Shoulders back and breathe in and ha! Excellent. And we're going to start off over here and we're going to just do a chord. So we'll break the room into three. Third of this room, hands up, are going to do excellent. We're going to go all together, breathe in. Ah, bigger guys, come on. We want the whole rest of the room to applaud for you. Here we go. Ah, give them a clap, come on. You have to keep the sound going. One more time, keep it going for longer, breathing in and ah, fantastic, keep going. Come on, guys, good. Oh, they're getting good. And now the middle are gonna go, ah, ready. And open your mouths, guys. Open your mouths. It really does help. Relax your jaws. Again. Ooh, give them a clap. And then the top over here are going to go. Breathe in. Open your mouth. Fantastic. And again. Give them a clap. Okay. So what we're going to do, and you had the most down there, I think, so you should be making a lot more noise, but we're going to do a three-part chord. We're going to keep just doing this. So when you run out of air, you just start the same note, okay? And I'm going to do that. That means crescendo, louder, softer, louder. And then we might close our eyes so we can hear all the parts in the room, okay? Now just remember, if your brain is going to go, oh my God, I can't believe I'm singing, I want to fall in a hole down the floor or something, just go, there is no one listening to your specific voice, okay? There's 80 people in this room. No one is listening to you. Okay, here we go. Breathe in. Ah, keep going, guys. Bigger. I'll give you the note again one more time. Here we go. Ah, keep going, guys. Keep going. Now we're going to close our eyes. Once we've started this time, we're going to close our eyes. I want you to tune in to the diverse voices in the room. I want you to tune out any self-talk that is saying, I can't do this. Because remember, being creative and innovative in disruptive time is getting out of your comfort zone. You have to do something every day that you're scared of. Okay, here we go. And don't fold your arms. Get going, guys. Okay. All right. Now, who was surprised how good that sounded? Hands up if you were surprised how good that sounded. It was beautiful. It was like the Deacon Prime Choir. It's just gorgeous. Okay. So what we decided to do 6 years ago was to use this concept of diversity in a social enterprise. And that social enterprise is Creativity Australia's With One Voice program. Who's heard of that? Okay, some of you have. And basically what we do is we bring together the most diverse people deliberately on a weekly basis in social inclusion choirs. We bring together people aged 9 to 90 of all faiths and all backgrounds. We bring together CEOs, doctors, lawyers, teachers, psychologists, accountants, bankers, with migrants, job seekers, and people with depression and disabilities. And every week we gather, we sing, and many of the people there have come along and said, I can't sing, and this is, you know, no way, I got told as a kid I can't sing. I was the one person, I can't tell you how many thousands of times, the teacher went past and they said that I should not make a sound, or that I should leave the room, or that I should stand in the back row. Who's heard that story? I've heard that thousands of times. It's outrageous. You know, we're silencing our voices. If we were in Africa or in the South Pacific, who's been to those churches in the South Pacific, in Fiji or Vanuatu? Do you hear the community all singing in harmony together? Do you think that they're sitting there going, oh, but I can't really sing? You know, no. You know, it's part of their culture. It's part of us as human beings to sing. To use our voice, not just to sing, but to find our true voice. It's a primal and tribal thing. We were given a voice for a reason, to speak and express ourselves. So if we are allowing ourselves to be silenced, or if we're feeling silenced in our workplace or whatever, we need to do something about that. Because one thing that robots can't do, well, they can talk. We found that out at our conference, because we had a little robot on stage the whole time who talked quite a lot, actually. But they can't talk with the same emotional variation. They can't really express themselves. They are programmed, whereas we actually have a creative program. So we share this experience of singing together at our choirs, but we share much more. We share supper, and we share a wish list. And every week at our choirs, people come together, and through the neuroscience of singing, which you just experienced, people's brains literally start to change. So in my TED talk, I talk about how singing together changes the brain. And when you sing with other people, your neural pathways connect in new and different ways. You release oxytocin, and your right temporal lobe of your brain starts to fire. And you become smarter, healthier, happier, and more creative. It truly is a wonder drug. You know, forget anything else. Forget alcohol, forget cigarettes, forget any other drugs you might like. Singing is the drug, okay? And so every week we have a wish list, and people can write down what they need in life on the wish list, and the wishes get read out at the choir programs by the wish list volunteers. And it might be, I need help to get a job, I want to have help to write a resume, I need job interview practice, I want to learn English, I want to learn how to use the internet, I want free singing lessons, I want to get a fridge. And every week other people put up their hands saying, I can help with that wish. And last year, over 500 wishes were granted in our choirs that we know of, and probably more. And over the past 6 years, we've created literally hundreds of jobs, work experience opportunities, connected people to counsellors, dentists, friendships, and even marriages. By the way, we're not a dating agency. I need to point that out. But on this photo here, you can see Nathalie. And Nathalie is a migrant from Cameroon who joined our choirs right at the beginning. She was referred by Brotherhood of St. Lawrence. She'd been looking for a job in Australia for 4 years as a trained accountant. She'd seen her sister massacred in front of her eyes in Cameroon, and was bringing up her own two children and her sister's child in Epping in West Melbourne, where she still lives. She came along to choir, and one day, quite early on, she was crying. We said, Nathalie, what's wrong? And she said, oh, I've got a job interview at ANZ Bank. And we said, that's great, what's wrong? You know, and she said, I don't think I can get the job. We said, of course you can get the job, Nathalie. And we started to give her mock interviews. Most of all, we gave her support. Nathalie felt like one of us, not like the outsider, because let's face it, we're all the same. We could be Nathalie, she could be us. And she started to feel like she belonged. And that's a powerful feeling. And we all belong. We're all part of this global human village. And when we put separateness between ourselves and others, we actually create walls and boxes. So we actually have to create those bridges of understanding. So Nathalie got a lot of support from us. And a couple of weeks later, she came back and she was smiling. She said, well, I got the job at ANZ. It's not as an accountant, but it's in the call centre. And we said, great. The choir started performing, and they perform for local events, corporate events and other events, and sing two or three songs, and they share stories. So we train people to share stories, because storytelling is a very powerful tool. It's a very powerful business tool as well, which we do a lot of work in. And Nathalie started, and others, telling their stories, and literally every performance that they give, the whole audience would stand and cheer. And a few weeks later, she emailed me and she said, Tania, I can't come to choir anymore. My hours have gone from 9 to 5 to 9 to 7:30. We said, well, what's going to happen? Who's going to feed your kids? She said, I don't know. And we said, can we speak to your supervisor? Oh, no, he doesn't really speak to any of the migrants, the people who are black. Wow. Well, anyway, fate intervened. And so we went along, and I was asked to give a speech at this huge conference that Julia Gillard and other people were speaking at the convention centre. And the theme of the conference was diversity. And I said to the organiser, hey, we've got this diversity choir called With One Voice Melbourne. Would you like to have them perform? And they looked at their little clip for the bushfire concert and they said, yeah, that sounds really good. And they made a donation, and people make donations for the choirs to perform. And they sang three songs, three stories, three songs. Nathalie managed to get out of work early that night to come. And at the end of the third song, and the whole audience is like literally standing and in tears because it's so inclusive, this woman comes running up to me and she says, could I have the mic, please? And she's got tears on her face, and I say, okay. She gets up on stage and she says, my name's Catherine McDowell. I'm managing director of ANZ Private Bank. And I want to say how humbling it is to see this model of social inclusion. We talk so much about diversity, but are we really capitalising on the diverse voices in our incredible country? You know, why are migrants driving taxis who have got PhDs? Why are incredible IT programmers driving taxis, you know, when we have skill shortages in this country? Anyway, I added that bit. She didn't say that bit. anyway, she said, this is so inspiring. And I said, look, thank you so much, Catherine. I've just got a bit of a favour to ask you, no pressure or anything. Nathalie in our choir, who works at the ANZ Bank, she needs some help with her hours and she really wants to be an accountant at the ANZ. Do you think that you could help her? Well, she hands Nathalie her business card. The whole audience is cheering. The next Tuesday, because we have this With One Voice Melbourne choir at the Sofitel every Tuesday, Nathalie turns back up to the choir and we're so rapt to see, and we go, Nathalie, what happened? She goes, I don't know what's going on, Tania, but every day my supervisor, he's coming to my desk and he asks me, how am I and do I have any problems? And so Catherine went on to help Nathalie improve her resume. She kept applying for every accounting role at ANZ, and finally she did get an accounting role at ANZ. But now she's been so inspired by the support she got from the community that she's done a degree in community development. She wants to help other migrants like her to become part of the community. Amazing story. So there's our wish list. You know, we literally have these wish trees, wish boxes at our choirs, and there's some of the outcomes of what we've had in the last few years with this charity. Like, it's truly amazing. And this just started from an idea. I just thought to myself, you know, we'd had the Choir of Hard Knocks, yeah? Who heard of the Choir of Hard Knocks? And I thought, why would we put all those disadvantaged people together? Like, what if we used a counterintuitive thought thinking and go, actually, if we put all those disadvantaged people together, they can't really help themselves enough. But what if we bring everyone together and come together as these diverse people? And that was really, it was an experiment. And I was lucky enough that the Sofitel donated their venue and supper for the last 6 years. Now in the seventh year, every week, they donate supper in a room for 80 to 100 people. And that then led to Geelong with Deakin and Dandenong and Sydney and Brisbane and Footscray and Heidelberg and St Kilda and all the other places where we now have these projects. And since my TED talk, there's a lady in Holland who set up four With One Voice programs there. There's a guy in America, and we have inquiries from all over Australia to set this model up. Because if we really want to have a community that is not suffering from the entrenched problems that we have. You know, we have rising mental health, rising child abuse rates, we have rising domestic violence, we have rising rates of pretty much every social problem you can imagine. Then we need to create communities bottom up and not rely on top-down social welfare government funding. And so my plea to all of you, I guess, today is to think about how you can reach out to people in your own communities, whether it's at work, at home, in your lives, in your neighbourhood, wherever, and just create these wish lists, these wish moments. Well, Beth is the person who changed my life. So she has cerebral palsy, and she joined our choir when she was 21, right at the start of the program again 6 years ago. And she was this incredible person, I guess I'd never seen someone with such a severe disability right next to me. And I always used to look at the chair as a barrier. And I somehow never really saw the person there, but every week that Beth came, she said, "This is the highlight of my week. I'm so happy to be here." And it was a lesson to us all. It was like, wow, well, if she can be so happy to be here, who are we not to be happy and grateful that we are here? And so even if I'm having the most grumpy day on a Tuesday, I go along to choir, and within about 5 minutes, I see Beth and all these other people, and I go, "Tania, get real, seriously, your problems are nothing. And you want to reach out and help these people, and not only that, they help you. Because they help you to actually see life for what it really is. Because again, we could all be Beth, she could be us. It's just the luck of the draw, where you're born and what happens to you." Beth made a few wishes last year. One of them was to get her first job, and one of the senior executives from Skilled happened to be in our choir. She got her first job at the Royal Show, and then she got her hours extended, and she was absolutely rapt. She also wished that she should stand in public for the first time, so she got this contraption made, and she stood in front of all of us just before Christmas. There was not a dry eye in the room. Every week she wishes for a male to give her supper and feed her, because she can't feed herself. And the men take it in turns, lining up to feed Beth, because it changes their lives. And her current wish is to have internet chat with a male, because naturally a person like Beth doesn't have enough interaction with the opposite sex. But it's changed Beth's life. So I want to show you just a short video just to give you a flavour. It is amazing what can happen when you come together on a weekly basis with people who are very diverse.
I joined this choir since I migrated from India.
I felt I found a new family in Australia.
This ANZ experience has took my singing to a different level.
The choir has just been the most wonderful thing for my career.
I was advertised by a choir member, so I applied, and fortunately I got the job.
You know, like we say, the angel was behind me. They were my angel. And I went through and I got a job with ANZ Bank.
Meeting together weekly in these programs, each of these people experience new self-esteem, hope, friendship.
Actually, we met in the choir last week, and this is our second time meet each other. And yeah, I feel very surprised and very thankful that I can meet such a good friend. Oh, I think this is the most important reason for me to keep coming.
This is why I got friends, because I can't do it anything for myself. I can't feel myself, I can't feel self-esteem. That's why I got friends. I can be who I want to be, apart from my disability. I can be, no one sees my wheelchair, they see me as a person.
The highlight of our year in 2011, apart from, of course, this afternoon, was to perform at the opening ceremony of the new Royal Children's Hospital, which was opened by Her Majesty the Queen.
This moment since is a group, not only a group, just a family. A family of singers.
You want to smell the beautiful perfume? You want to be happy? Come with me.
You can clap. So you know, my invitation to you is come and join us. You know, like, you can all sing, you all know that now. So, and it doesn't matter if you couldn't sing anyhow, but you all can sing because we're human beings and we're part of the human tribe of singers. And join us at one of these tribes, or set up your own tribe, or contact us. But really, like, this open invitation here for you to get involved, share this with your friends and so on. It's really special. It is life-changing. I'm telling you, it's changed my life and it's changed a lot of people's lives. And the outcomes have been great. And we actually just did some research with Swinburne and the Mitchell Institute and Beyond Blue, and it showed some incredible outcomes there around reducing anxiety and depression, improving skills for work and life and so on. It's powerful work. Whoops, there we go. So I wanted to mention a couple of things that I think it's really important to do. If you're going to become these creative, innovative, and you already are because you're here, but if you want to become more creative and innovative in this era of disruption, this, I've got some handouts, of course, on your table there. But also, as I said, have what I like to call positive human collisions. Connect with people who are really different from you on a regular basis. Fail. Think of failure as the first attempt in learning. When someone fails, don't punish them. Just say, let's try that again. I mean, if they fail really badly, too often, you might have to let them go. But embrace failure, because it is truly, no entrepreneur has ever succeeded without failing a lot of times. Steve Jobs, all of the people, Bill Gates, Richard Branson, they talk all the time about how much and often they've failed. Go into your right-brained headspace as often as possible through the methods that I described, and also, like, meditation's another great one, yoga. Ask questions, what if, why not, and so on. Now, the other thing that I want to invite you to do is to help us to get every single postcode in Australia singing for good. You've all heard of Movember, yeah? So it's all about furry hair on our faces, which some of us can't really do. And we might not want to. So this is about groups of two or more people from any school, club, company, university, workplace, singing together any song you like that means a lot to you, videoing it on your iPhone or other device, putting it up on YouTube, and then getting your friends and networks to vote for you and donate to support disadvantaged people. And we have all these different categories. We have best bloke sing, best girl sing, best family sing, best regional sing. We're even going to have a best truckie sing, best farmer sing, best university sing, best school sing. We have cash prizes for schools, etc. And so the aim is to get everyone in Australia singing. There's the categories right there. And there's more. You can make up your own category. We don't mind. Now, I don't know if you know, but Movember also started just with a wacky idea. 30 guys decided it would be a lark if they grew moustaches. They didn't plan to raise any money. They thought after the first year, hey, people think this is a bit cool. So the next year, they got 350 entries and raised about $50,000. Thought, this is really cool. Let's raise some funds for men's health and so on. By the end of last year, who knows how much they raised? $579 million. Towards men's health and mental health. Can you imagine if we could get Sing for Good, support disadvantaged people around Australia to even a fraction of that amount? And each of you can put in entries. So my challenge to you all is, you all live in different postcodes, please join with us. And I'll just show you one little video to finish off to inspire you. Oops.
Okay, hit it.
Go.
I heard he sang a good song. I heard he had a style.
Sing to you, and you sing for me.
So what a way to linger and stay deep in the soul of a child.
fighting forever. Now we're united together. Two nations playing as one to reach our goal.
Moving way too fast and we crushed it. But it's in the past. We can make this leap as we turn this to waterfall.
Man, they said you better accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In Between.
You want
it!
You got it!
See you!
You want it! What?
You got it!
Joy of soul carries us along.
Go. My wish to all of you, sing for good, because singing does you good and you'll be doing good for the whole of Australia. And the other thing, of course, is creative innovation, and maybe next year we'll probably do Creative Innovation 2016. Haven't decided on the theme yet, but it will be about disruption again, but probably an extension of disruption, because who knows what is going to happen by 2016. You saw some of those predictions. So. It's said that we go through most of our lives with our music unplayed. Imagine if we could unlock just 5% more of our creativity. Imagine how we could all be changing the world even more than we are right now. So go forth, unlock your symphonies, your concertos. Sing like no one's listening. Love like you've never been hurt. Dance like nobody's watching. And live like it's heaven on earth. That's the title of my new CD, Heaven on Earth. And Rabbi Hillel said, if I'm not for myself, who will be for me? And if I'm only for myself, what am I? And if not now, when? So go forth, conquer, do it now. Thank you. Thank you. Now we have time for some questions, don't we? Yeah. If you ask some good questions, if you want, I may sing a song for you. Yes?
Tania, you said that with any great innovation or creativity there needs to be some kind of failure along the way. So
yeah.
With the diversity choirs that you put together,
yeah.
I guess what are the major challenges that you've experienced in that? I mean, the top three.
So many challenges. Yeah. And we're still experiencing them because what we're doing is so out of the box. So one of the big challenges with the diversity choirs is getting enough balance of people who are disadvantaged and more fortunate. So all of us in this room are more fortunate. We can, and in some of our choirs we have more disadvantaged people and in others we have more fortunate. And the idea is to get that balance because otherwise the wish list doesn't work. That's one challenge. The other challenge is getting people who can afford to make donations to actually be more philanthropic. So we invite people who come to the choirs to support someone less fortunate. It costs about $10 a week or $500 a year to be a participant, which is really cheap when you get supper and everything. You know, we do, it costs $20 to go to a yoga class. But we ask people, would you like to sponsor someone else for $500 a year, change their life? Some people do it, of course, but we'd love to see lots more people demonstrating individual philanthropy. And then it's just about getting our systems, our IT systems, really good so that we can keep tracking people, having, you know, the roles and the databases right and making sure that people renew their memberships and just all that stuff that we have to deal with in our own systems and processes. Then the other thing too is just getting people to realise when they're funding us that this is way more than a choir. This is changing, this is creating a community model, and a lot of funding bodies go, but it's just a choir. Why would we fund a choir? Or we never fund choirs, or, you know, yeah, we already fund other choirs. But we go, but this choir's not like that choir, it's a different choir. So there's lots and lots of challenges to actually get very clear on what we're doing, and to make it very clear to other stakeholders and potential funders, and just raising the money to keep the charity going. I do this pro bono, the charity work, and we have a small team, and we have quite a lot of volunteers in the charity, but just raising the funds to keep going. And I want to get to sustainability so that we can just go, you know, I founded another charity 15 years ago, the Song Room. It's gone brilliantly, but it's for kids. Kids are much more, you know, dare I say it, sexy. You know, like, funding children is much easier than funding diverse ages of backgrounds and people like that, you know. We always love helping kids, but we're all kids at heart, and everyone deserves a chance to have their voice heard, not just children. Any other questions? More questions? Come on, guys. Creative. Can we creative questions? Yes, good.
I'll tell you, it's Kate. Mine's more of a comment than a question. I think it's really sad, given, you know, what we do know about singing, that it was either last or equal last or second last on the IBM CEO of what's important was humility.
Yes, yes.
That was second last.
That's terrible.
I think that's an indictment. If they don't see that creativity, if they want creativity,
then they've got to have
to foster humility and just demonstrate humility themselves.
Absolutely. And so, new surveys are demonstrating this. Like, so that was a survey from 5 years ago now, or nearly 4.5 years ago that survey was done. But new surveys are demonstrating that compassion and humility are very important in leaders of the future. And let's face it, no one wants to be have this massive ego around them. It's really bad, you know. So we all have to let go of as much of our ego as we can. It's an ongoing process, because we all have that ego part of ourselves, and it helps us to achieve. But we also have to find a balance between that and connecting with the bigger picture and other people. So I totally agree with you. Yes, other questions? Yes.
Just an addition to that comment. The way I saw that slide was that it wasn't second last, it was actually in the top 10. So there's obviously a load more on that list that there could be.
And that's right too.
The fact that humility was
up there
at number 9, I thought it was actually quite good.
It's getting higher. But yes, that's right. Other questions? I can't sing unless there's at least a couple more questions here. Good. Yes?
How do you stay motivated and energized? This is a lot of work, and you continue being creative and innovative. You get exhausted.
Oh, yeah, I do. I do get really tired. But because I'm doing something that I feel so inspired about, it comes down to doing what you are very passionate about, and that gives you the energy. So if you're feeling tired a lot, you're probably either lacking in purpose, you're working in a place that's draining your energy, but that's again because you're lacking in purpose, because if you had a lot of purpose, you probably wouldn't be there. And it's about just being so inspired every day that even though I'm exhausted, I just keep going, because I want, you know, every week we get emails and letters from these people saying how we've changed their lives. And with the conference and other things, every one of us can change the world, you know, in our own way. You know, it's like Mahatma Gandhi said, you know, be the change you want to see in the world. And so we all have to change, and we all owe it to ourselves to be working and putting all those hours a week into something that we really love doing.
Tanya,
yes.
What do you do for a day job?
What do I do for a day job? Well, so how I earn money is I earn money singing. So tonight I'm launching this massive $20 million apartment down at Docklands for Mervac. I do a lot of public speaking, and I work a lot with top teams. So I work with top 100s of, you know, McKinsey, Pricewaterhouse, ANZ, other companies, working with teams to unlock a culture of innovation. And then the other way I earn money is through the conference, providing that we break even. people pay to come, and then we have to, you know, balance that out with how much it costs the speakers, which is hundreds of thousands of dollars in the venue. But if enough people come, and this year a lot of people came, I mean, ANZ alone sent 350 people to our conference. We had 900 people come through our conference. But, you know, it's it's been a long road. And, you know, I was one of those people for a long time. I just had the singing as my form of income for a long time. And that was tough. And I look at a lot of my friends now who are still trying to make a living doing that. And I think it is really, really difficult being an artist. And one of my things around artists is they have to learn more business skills, not to sell out on themselves, but just so that they can create jobs. The other thing I think that's important to say is that the era of having a job for life is, you know, clearly over, and we have to create our own jobs. And even if you're working in a company, the more valuable you are will be how much you can create work and revenue and opportunities for that company. Not just go, you know, as you go through your job, don't just do your job, do more than your job. Go, actually, as you talk to a client, and I say this to my EA all the time, as you're talking, think outside the box, think 360 degrees. How else could we engage with that client or stakeholder? What haven't we done with that person? How could they refer us to someone else? You know, one more, yes.
Twitter handle?
Yes, sorry, I should have said that at the start, at Tania de Jong. And if you, yeah, I think my team have been tweeting a bit during this session, and please do tweet, and please, with the TED Talk, I'd love you to watch it and share it massively, because, you know, Ken Robinson's had 25 million views, like, that's a few more zeros on the end of mine, but that's not bad, I could get there. And I have my brand new CD just come out, Heaven on Earth. It's very beautiful. And please do give me your card if you'd like to stay in touch, and we'll give you updates on all of our events. And we have lots of information here and stuff like that. So, oh, there's some contacts too. So would you like a song?
Yes.
Okay, any particular, so I'll give you a choice. You can either have, let me think now. Edith Piaf's La Vie en Rose, Somewhere from West Side Story, or Summertime by George Gershwin. Now, hang on, you're going to vote, and you're going to get to put your hands up only once. Okay, La Vie en Rose. That's a lot of people. Okay, Somewhere. Not many people. Summertime. Okay, Summertime wins it. Hang on, I'll just get the orchestra cued. Thank you again, and you're going to...
I am, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I think certainly another round of applause, please, for Tania.
Mm.
And just to finish, and Tania, it's always very inspiring to hear about the work you do with One Voice. Very inspiring, so I encourage everyone to get involved where they can. As Tania touched on, creativity and innovation aren't just abstract themes, abstract things. They do have a direct correlation to how you can improve productivity and champion and see through change within an organisation. And Tania and Deacon Prime work together on programs to assist organisations with that. So if you need some help to break out from not always doing it this way, please come have a chat to the team at Deacon Prime and or directly to Tania. Thank you very much for your time today. We've really enjoyed having you, and one more final round of applause.
Thank you. And come and say hi. And befriend an alien. Talk to someone you haven't met before you leave as well.